questions and make comments. I too was wondering how you measured the decibel level in those buildings when you said if the windows were closed. And are you saying that we have acceptable decibel levels if we close our windows? Like, that just seems like, and I may be misinterpreting what you said exactly, but that's how it read that, to me.
So I'll maybe interpret and then turn it over, but what I would say is that there's two parts of the presentation. There's what the reading is, unmitigated, so what the decibel increase is, and then we do look at what helps reduce that sound. And
so we could close our windows so that
in a building,
the decibel level is acceptable.
No. So what it's saying is that for a building that has already walls and glass windows, when it's an electric train, those are more effective at mitigating the noise.
That's
right. But that's what is intended by that, in that there's materials there currently that become more effective when you remove the low frequency vibration that right now people, and I live by rail border myself, but you feel that it shakes your windows. The low frequency vibration that comes off of the diesel engines has a different impact on materials like windows and walls than the electric train.
So what about when windows are open? What's the measurement?
Yeah. So that was the unmitigated measurement.
Yeah, that's correct. So what we tried to document is the reduction in sound levels that would be present if the windows closed with electric train. So it's a relative decrease for electric train noise compared to diesel train noise. With windows open, there are, and we've been pretty clear that there are no benefits if your windows are open, or the benefits are minimal. So is it the same increase? Yeah, I'm just reporting the findings of the study. I'm not trying to,
Thank you. These are what the facts are. Thank you for your honesty.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, so in all of this, there doesn't seem to be like a people assessment. So with the Metrolinx UP Express, I don't know what the decibel levels and stuff were there, but one of the complaints that is frequently heard in this neighborhood is the constant ringing of the bells. So those bells may not exceed decibel levels, but they certainly are impinging on the psychological health of the neighborhood because they're every 15 minutes throughout the day. So I'm just making a point that I'm not seeing that sort of people bit in here. The next thing, sorry, I'm going to take time because you seem to be just pushing through, and I don't get the feeling that you're going to be coming back.
We'll be coming back often.
Underneath your drawing here of the galaxy way there, your findings, I don't know if this was deliberate or not, but you have goldenrod and I think purple loosestrife, which is an invasive species, and goldenrod, it's not a noxious plant, but it is a weed. And it's sort of, to me, that picture shows what we're going to get. We're going to get an invasive species, and we're going to get a weed underneath there. And I think that that's very accurate. I don't think we're going to have anything else. One last thing. You keep saying that you're going to consult with your continuing discussions, you're working with your partners, you're welcoming community input, you're having active discussions. And yet, the City of Toronto gave you their partnership, their working partners, their whatever, like your bedfellows. They said, tunnel. You have a community here that has said, given you our input, and yet really when I look at this, and I've been coming to all of these meetings, I don't see the response to the community. I sure.
I would say that in terms of the greenway and the types of species and what the plans are for that, that is why we're starting the community advisory committee, because that isn't the final plan. We do need to continue to work through that. And as I said to the gentleman earlier, part of that is a conversation with the city about what can be maintained and what's going to happen. So to that point, that is something that we will continue to work through. And we do want it to be something that both the community wants and that can be easily maintained.
Okay, but you see, there you are saying it's an ongoing conversation. And yet, this is I don't know how many years in the making. And it's been something that community has brought up. That this really, we are worried that this is going to be a graffiti-filled, dangerous place.
Absolutely.
And I don't think... lipstick on this
cake,
and it's not going to change. And so, look at the UPS. Look at the UPS, and you'll see. But you see that there was so little thought even put into what's underneath this in your drawings after 2 years or whatever it is. Just shows to me that the things that are important to people that make a community, that make it livable, aren't even on your radar.
Yeah. So I have three questions. One is with this stainless steel mirror. What noise will that bring? And what maintenance will be required to keep it looking the way it is in your illustrations for the duration of its life? Secondly, the city at meetings that I've been has publicly said they are not committing anything to maintenance, that this is Metrolinx land. Do you have any evidence that their perspective has changed? Thirdly, how much is Metrolinx committing to this endowment fund should this project move forward in maintaining the land so that this community, in the worst case scenario that this is actually built, can use it?
So I'll start with your last question first, and then I'll pass over to Beth in terms of the actual stainless steel, the absorptive quality, and the maintenance of it. What I would say in terms of the endowment and the maintenance, what we've been looking at is we're looking at a standard over a 30-year time span to see how much it costs on average to maintain something of this length and width as an average, and putting that money into an endowment fund. And we are looking at that with the City of Toronto to ensure that there's sufficient funds in that. But that is part of the conversation about maintenance and the final plan underneath the bridge. So we have heard that in terms of the panel report recommendations that asked us about governance and endowment and upkeep, and we've also heard from the city their concerns about the ability to upkeep it. So that is an ongoing conversation, and it will be based on, no, it's going to be based on what the standard of care and what it costs to maintain, and we have to start somewhere in that kind of space.
But shouldn't that come first before the design? How can you be pushing for these public rounds when we haven't figured out if and who is going to maintain it?
Well, I think part of the design will also determine what the upkeep and maintenance is. So I think it's a concurrent process, but it is. It's a concurrent process. So for instance, in the initial conversations, the skylight wasn't part of the design. The skylight allows bottom light to actually maintain part of the space under the overpass. That has an impact on long-term maintenance and what happens under that space instead of watering it or doing some other type of care. So the two are intertwined, and the two need to be worked out together so that whatever is built to this form, whatever is put in, can be properly maintained.
So Metrolinx is going to commit to spending having 100% of the maintenance covered.
We have committed to working that out with the city and looking at the endowment fund, and we will be back with that commitment. We also committed to your point about the actual design. So at the last public meeting, the additional greenway and design structure came to 140 million, and we committed in January to funding the full cost of that 140 million, which includes the public plan. That's
maintenance.
And maintenance is going to be determined, but we also need to understand what that maintenance cost is before we pick a random number in terms of maintenance. So we hear loud and clear that maintenance is important, and we will be coming back with more information on maintenance. But I'll let Beth speak to the actual stainless steel
and the city's budget.
I can't speak for the city, but we are actively working with the city on these elements.
One thing about the stainless steel cladding, so the stainless steel is on the outside and there's a sound absorptive material on the inside. So the thinking behind kind of putting the stainless in place was that it would break down, it would soften the visual quality of the bridge. And where that stainless steel goes and how it goes is very much something that we want to talk with the community about in the next phase of design. But what's important is that we've got a placeholder in there for a premium, high quality material that is a much more visually acceptable alternative than a bare concrete structure, which would be much more difficult to keep clean of graffiti. The stainless steel structure, and maybe Ray can speak to this because I know that your team has used this material, and it comes in a number of different finishes, from a what's called a pillowed surface to a more burnished surface, according to what people want to see in the community.
What is the sound reducing material?
I'm sorry?
What is the sound reducing material?
I'm going to have to pass that over to Sam, but can we just finish talking about
this? Let's finish the same skill. We'll handle it. We're going to get you to
with regards to the stainless steel, we used this material on building before, and one of the things is to reduce sound because we built several mockups of how this material is applied. It was reinforcing behind, and what we used in this instance, Sam had a different strategy, that we used a sound insulation, almost like a rock salt product, to batten down the stainless steel behind. So basically, to almost reinforce the steel while providing the sound filtering.
Is there an example we can see the steel that's used somewhere in the GTA? In the
world?
We have a building in Edmonton that.
Where in the world have you seen a stainless steel bridge from?
So we do have examples of that online. They use it quite a bit in the, I believe the UK has some examples of public structures where this is used to, as was discussed, to soften the elements of it, reflect the trees where it can, and
that is it.
So, but it is online, and I'm happy to send that to you. Do you want to?
Sure.
Yeah. I was going to say, in Canada, in BC, they use them in highway overpasses. They use the same strategy. Sometimes they tilt the panels a bit up so it reflects the sky directly, but it has been used in Canada on fairly pedestrian.
And how do they maintain them in those instances? And what is the maintenance cost? And also, what's the vibration of them?
Vibration is not an issue because they're fixed to the bridge. The bridge is designed to absorb the vibration from the trees, and then you have the stainless steel panels affixed to them, so it's not really an issue. In terms of cleaning,
do they use an urban setting?
So if we can just finish the one question, and then we will continue to move through the project.
Yeah, and, I mean, stainless steel is largely self-cleaning. I would imagine at the end of the diesel cycle, you'd want to do a major sort of top-to-bottom clean, and then after electrification, it won't be an issue. But stainless steel buildings have been built in the cities throughout the world, and they tend to wash the dirt off. You might get some streaking, but not much, especially with the polished finish.
And I would add, at the last meeting, we had an example of the stainless steel, but we also had information, which I could send back around following this meeting if you signed up to the email list, that was about graffiti specifically and a graffiti strategy, and that the stainless steel can actually be washed with the solution, and it's easier to remove graffiti than some of the concrete elements that you see. So we do have information in detail on that, and we're happy to share that as well. But I'm gonna try to keep going and take the next question, because we do have a permit, and at some point I need to wrap the evening up. So actually, can I just take the